Well, thank you all for coming, and those of you online as well. I'm really excited to introduce today's speaker, but I'll mutilate his name, unfortunately, Subir Sachdev.
Very good.
He's a Smith Professor of Physics at Harvard University. Subir received his PhD from Harvard and a Master of Arts from Harvard, and he got his bachelor's degree in physics down the street at MIT. Too many honors for me to list, but I'll just mention a few. Elected to the American Academy of Arts and Sciences. He's in the Academy, National Academies of Science in both India and the U.S. He's held professional positions at Bell Labs and Yale and Harvard, and as I say, a host of awards. Subir is going to talk to us about quantum mechanics today, statistical mechanics today, and then quantum mechanics tomorrow. And I'm equally excited with both talks. Tomorrow's lecture will be a Peterson lecture. It's going to be for the general public. And so all of y'all tell your friends to come, because then they'll finally understand why you're so crazy about quantum mechanics and physics and things. So tell all your friends to come tomorrow. And it's going to be at the same time, 4:30, same place, 103, spread the word. It's going to be really exciting. So not take any more time away from our speaker. Take it away.
Okay, well, thank you very much for the kind introduction and for the invitation to come here. Can you all hear me okay? And I hope the, all right. Okay, so my title is Statistical Mechanics of Strange Metals and Black Holes. It is about quantum mechanics, but will involve a lot of statistical mechanics too. And so it concerns topics which probably are unfamiliar to many of you here, but not to worry, even the topic of black holes was unfamiliar to me until, well, not so far back. And I'll try to introduce the ideas starting from, you know, the central concepts. So, but before I get into it, let me just, so I'm going to begin by just reviewing two central ideas in statistical mechanics due to Boltzmann from the 19th century, which will be central to the topics I'll be discussing. So the first great idea by Boltzmann from 1870 is the statistical interpretation of entropy. So entropy, previous to Boltzmann, was a concept invented by people, you know, building engines and in the science of thermodynamics and the second law of thermodynamics, which had been empirically observed and tested. And then Clausius came up with the idea of defining entropy in terms of heat flows in and out of any given body. It was Boltzmann who changed the meaning of entropy completely, gave a microscopic definition of entropy as a measure of randomness, something we take for granted today, but it wasn't at all clear in the early days what entropy is. So this is his famous formula, S equals K log W, which is on his gravestone. So W here is a measure of the total number of possible microscopic states that are consistent with a certain macroscopic thermodynamic observable. So it's not quite that well defined, but nevertheless, once you take a log, it becomes very precisely defined in the thermodynamic limit. Okay, but one of the remarkable things is that Boltzmann's definition becomes even easier to imply once you go to quantum mechanics, which of course didn't appear on the scene until 1900, when Planck did his famous black body experiment. So in quantum mechanics, you replace W by the density of quantum states. You imagine you can solve Schrodinger's equation for whatever system you're studying. You find all the energy eigenvalues, and you measure the density of those eigenvalues in some interval that you choose. And then the log of the density of states is then the entropy. Okay, so that's the one great contribution by Boltzmann. So Boltzmann came upon this by thinking about a dilute classical gas, like the molecules in this room, thinking about its properties. And his other great contribution was really describing the time evolution of a given gas. And this time evolution was expressed in terms of microscopic terms, in terms of the Boltzmann distribution function, Fp, which is a measure of the number of particles with a certain momentum p. Here, let me just imagine things are spatially uniform. So this was also, you know, in some sense, a revolutionary step, because at the time, in 1872, even the existence of molecules was not an accepted fact. So Boltzmann postulated, assumed molecules were present in the air, and then wrote down an equation for them. Now, the left-hand side of the equation is essentially Newton's laws for individual molecules in the presence of some force in these new variables, so let's not worry about it. The right-hand side is Boltzmann's innovation, and that's the collision term. So the molecules are moving around freely, and if they didn't feel each other, well, nothing interesting would happen. But they do collide every now and then. And so the collision, the right-hand side is roughly the collision rate. And it's Boltzmann made a bold assumption that the collisions are statistically independent, that what happens in one collision doesn't affect what happens subsequently. You don't have to worry about whether these two particles which are colliding had collided with some other particle before. So with this assumption of statistical independence, you can say the collision rate is just proportional to the density of particles in state P and the density of particles in state P1. And this is the time-reversed collision, which also happens. All right, so this is the famous Boltzmann equation with describing motion of particles. And from this collision term, you can go from the motion of individual particles to the collective properties of a gas, describe its its behavior, like its viscosity, and various other macroscopic phenomena, which are really revolutionary things that we've continued to do this day following on the Boltzmann equation. Okay, so one of the amazing things is that, just like the definition of entropy, Boltzmann equation, which is written for a dilute classical gas with rare collisions, also applies with very small changes to a dense quantum gas. In some sense, making things dense and making them quantum kind of tend to cancel each other in a very interesting way. So if you compare the Boltzmann equation for the classical gas versus a dense quantum gas, this is obviously the dense quantum gas I'm interested in is the gas you have in any metal, like silver or gold or copper. Electrons are flowing in it when current flows, and that's described by this equation. And the main difference, so why are collisions so rare, even in a dense quantum gas? Well, it so turns out that it's the exclusion principle that makes them rare. So if you now look at the right-hand side of Boltzmann equation here, the main difference is this F times F has been replaced by F times F times 1 minus F of the final states, P2 and P3. So this is simply the requirement that if these particles are colliding, they better go into a state that's empty. If it's not empty, they're not allowed to go there by the exclusion principle. And so you just add the exclusion principle in, and that's really the only change you essentially have to make. You also make a further assumption of statistical independence of collisions, and then you have essentially a complete description of the motion of electrons in a metal. And it's not an exaggeration to say that it's this Boltzmann equation that's the foundation of all of solid-state physics till almost everything people did, and very successfully in theories of metals, insulators, superconductors, semiconductors, all built upon solving this Boltzmann equation in different situations, with a few other bells and whistles, but that's really what it was. So amazingly, you could just treat this very complicated quantum system with many trillions of particles in terms of distribution function for individual particles which occasionally collide with each other, just like Boltzmann did for the classical gas in the 19th century. And of course, the right-hand side is small because either all the particles are occupied, in which case at a given energy range, in which case the collision doesn't happen, or they're all empty, in which case it doesn't happen either. You have to be right at the boundary, at what's called the Fermi surface, for some of them to be occupied and some of them to be empty for the collision to proceed. And that becomes very rare at low temperatures. Okay. All right. So that's all good. So if you take Boltzmann's theory, and as I said, we can apply it to electrons moving in a metal. And if you do that, say a metal like copper, you have all these electrons moving around, and you apply Boltzmann equation to their motion, you can come up with a very successful theory of what goes on. You can predict in detail a lot of its properties. For example, you can predict its resistivity. How does the resistivity depend on temperature? So what Boltzmann equation tells you is that the time between scattering events of these particles in this dense quantum gas diverges as temperature goes to zero as 1 over temperature squared. So this is something you can derive from the collision term, or even more simply, from Fermi's golden rule, if you take a basic course in solid-state physics. And from this collision rate, you can then, the inverse of the collision rate basically determines the resistivity. And so the resistivity must increase as a power of t squared, as it indeed does in lots of experiments. So that's just a simple example of the kind of thing you can compute. There's a lot more you can do quantitatively, which works extremely well. All right, so that would be the end of my talk if I was talking about copper. But our interest here is in materials where Boltzmann fails. That's really what my talk's about. When does Boltzmann fail, and how does it fail, and what do you replace it by? And that's not an easy question to answer. So it will fail when successive collisions are not independent. And you can't think of these collisions just happening. Once they happen, you forget about it. Successive collisions are correlated, and in fact, they are entangled with each other. The quantum correlations spread over longer times, and you can't treat the collisions independently. But at least you can ask, when will this fail? So one simple argument is like a quantum uncertainty principle. Surely at a given temperature, the uncertainty of energy of a given electron is kBT, and the time between collisions should be longer so that you can even define its energy. So this tells you, roughly speaking, that tau must be much longer than what now people call the Planckian time, which is Planck's constant divided by kBT. So this is a time that you can deduce knowing the temperature. That's all you need to know. It must be the case for this theory to work that this time is much longer than h bar over kT. And in fact, it is the case. You can just see right here, if you'd make the temperature low enough, which is the main regime I'm interested in, 1 over t squared will always become bigger than 1 over t. So at low enough temperatures, this always works in copper. Or you would think in almost any material, which is what people thought for the longest time, that eventually Boltzmann works. All right. So that, in that sense, there was a big shock starting in the... Yes. Sure, yeah, I'm not going into that, but sure, you have to include that to get the proper... Right, well, at very low temperature, the electron interactions dominate. Okay, so these are the high-temperature superconductors which were discovered in 1987, yttrium, barium, copper oxide being one of them right here. And this at a certain chemical composition measured by this axis P has a critical temperature nearly 100 Kelvin, which is above the boiling point of good nitrogen. So you can do little lecture demonstrations with superconductors, as I'm sure you've seen. I'll have a movie of something like that tomorrow. However, if you take these materials and look at them right above TC, you have the regime which is now called the strange metal. And this is simply a statement of our ignorance. This is a metal in which the theory that was so successful in copper completely fails. You might say, well, actually, this is not really at low temperatures. That's 200 Kelvin. But on the natural scale for a metal, 200 Kelvin is extremely low. All the other natural energy scales are thousands of Kelvin. But even more, you can suppress the superconductivity by various tricks and make the strange metal go down to zero temperature. So one recent experiment is right here, where they measured by looking at the resistivity in a magnetic field. I'm pointing at different angles. You can deduce the scattering time. So I won't go into any of the details, but just look at the red data. So there's an isotropic component of the scattering time, which is isotropic, as this plot shows. And this plot, you plot the scattering time as a function of temperature, down to very low temperatures here. And you can see that it's linear in temperature. So in fact, here, there was this Planckian bound I mentioned here, that this h bar over tau must be bigger than tau must be bigger than h bar over kt. And what you find here, that's exactly equal to it. H bar over tau is kt with a factor alpha, which is close to 1. So somehow, this is clearly then a system in which Boltzmann's idea of independent particles totally fails. We have to worry about correlations between different collisions. We need a theory for understanding how current flows in such a system. The current is not flowing by motion of individual electrons. It's flowing, if you wish, by some entangled soup of electrons. Much harder problem to solve. This is some other data on resistivity in other materials and also in twisted bilayer graphene, all showing this Planckian time, scattering time. Okay, so this raises many questions. As I've said, we need a theory for current flow in a strange metal in this entangled soup of electron. We need to understand why this collision time, as measured by resistivity, saturates at this Planckian value. It never gets shorter than that. It seems to saturate at the lower bound. There seems to be a lower bound. And then eventually we know a lot of these strange metals, as many materials show them, all of them go superconducting under the right conditions. I won't address that, but that's really the biggest problem. I mean, the most interesting problem in some sense, because all we care about is to have a superconductor at even higher temperatures. So theory should give us some guidance in what the critical temperature is, and we can only figure that out if you understand the strange metal. That's really the bottom line. That's one of the big reasons I've been worrying about the strange metal for such a long time. Okay, so that's solid-state physics. And I'll tell you about some ideas how to answer those questions, if I time things right, towards the end of my talk. But now I'm going to talk about something completely different, seemingly different, which is black holes and quantum effects near black holes. The remarkable fact that I'm driving towards, as we'll see, that the same set of ideas and even literally the same models will apply to these very different systems. And the common theme in both systems is we have to worry about complicated entanglement of millions of electrons or millions of quantum particles and worry about the collective properties of this entangled system. All right, so let me just introduce what are black holes. So black holes are solutions of Einstein's theory of general relativity, found by Schwarzschild originally. And the statement is that there are, if an object is so dense that nothing can ever escape, including light, because the gravitational pull is so strong when once you're inside the horizon of radius 2 gm over c squared. So any object, if you squeeze it down to this radius, will become a black hole. If you want to squeeze the Earth into a black hole, you have to make it the size of a pea. So that's how dense black holes are. Nobody ever believed such thing existed in the 1930s when these were solutions of Einstein's equations, but they do exist. They're everywhere. Every galaxy has a supermassive black hole in its center, including our own, and so on. Okay, So these are big, heavy objects, which are constantly eating stars and growing heavier, including at the center of our galaxy. But just for the fun of it, really, because there's no experiment that has so far tested such things, you can ask, what about quantum effects near a black hole? So we do the basic thought experiment of EPR, where you take an entangled pair of electrons. So this is two electrons, say, in a hydrogen molecule. One of them is spin up and the other is spin down, and they're in this entangled superposition state. And you imagine a thought experiment where one electron falls inside a black hole and the other one is with you outside the black hole. Now, as with any entangled pair, it means the entanglement is still preserved. So it's only if you look at this one and you see it to be up, then the other one collapses to be down, or vice versa. So that's the famous EPR quote-unquote paradox. I'll introduce this more gently tomorrow, but for now I assume the audience here is familiar with this. But now imagine doing the EPR experiment across a black hole horizon. And so if you're outside and you have this particular electron in your hand, you can never find out what's happened to the other one. So, you know, even if there was an observer here, that observer can never send you information on what the observer saw. So as far as you're concerned, this horizon really is the end of the universe. And you have one electron in your hand, and it's random. It's not entangled with anything, it's just totally random. And randomness is entropy, it's temperature, as Boltzmann told us. So that's basically a crude version of the argument that Hawking made in 1975, that black hole horizons, once you include entanglement into account, are not just black. They're actually radiating, they have a temperature, they're like a black body at a certain non-zero temperature. And in fact, Hawking even computed the temperature. It's this number right here. And also the entropy, which is this particular formula where A is the surface area of the black hole. Okay, so I want to give you just a little introduction to how these result came about. I mean, there's different arguments, but they all boil down to a following argument, which, you know, you could be skeptical about. Today we know the argument was, is correct. Hawking's result is completely correct. There's a lot of evidence for it today. But in 1973 or 1974, this was not clear. So what was the type of calculation that Hawking did? Well, he did a calculation which is the analog of the old Bohr-Sommerfeld semi-classical theory. So one way of formulating Bohr's semi-classical theory is to use the Feynman path integral. So suppose I want to do the quantum mechanics of a particle. What does Feynman say? Feynman says you take, if your particle going from here to there, you just take, pick a path and you compute the action, the classical action for that path. And then you pick another one, and you pick another one, and you sum all of them with a factor of e to the I times the action divided by h bar. And you do that sum, and you'll get Schrodinger's equation. So that's the Feynman path integral. That's too hard to do the sum. So you say, well, let me just take the saddle point of this path integral, the least action path, and just put it in this Feynman path integral. Assume it's dominated by the least action. That will basically give you the old quantum theory of Bohr and Sommerfeld, just the saddle point action you just take the saddle point classical action, divide by h bar, and that gives you a quantum amplitude. All right, so let's just take that approach of Feynman and apply it to gravity. So Einstein taught us that gravity is described, the degrees of freedom of gravity are the space-time metric itself. So now you have to take the time evolution of the space-time metric over all possible metrics. So this is a much bigger integral than the sum all possible paths of a particle. It's a field theory, it's a quantum field theory, where the field is the space-time metric itself. That's g mu nu. If you want to include electromagnetism, you also have to take the path integral over all possible electromagnetic fields. And now Einstein and Maxwell told us what this action is. I've just written this down here. It's some function or functional of the metric and the space-time and the gauge field. And you integrate it over all space and time, and then you compute the time evolution. Okay, well, that's not what I've written here. And what I'm doing here is doing a trick, which is instead of computing the time evolution operator, I'm computing, which this is the time evolution operator. Then Boltzmann told us the partition function of this object. And you can see they're almost exactly the same, except you replace time by h bar over kt. So basically, that's what I've done over here. The time is going from 0 to h bar over kt, and I've removed the I. So then you get the partition function, not the time evolution operator. We want the partition function because that's what gives us the entropy and the temperature and so on. All right, so this is the path integral you have to do. No one knows how to do this path integral, even today. It's actually not even well defined. It's full of infinities. Didn't bother Gibbons and Hawking. They said, we don't care. Let's just take the saddle point. And if you take the saddle point of this action and compute this, there's one other trick where, you know, this space-time ends up looking like a cigar in imaginary time because the time here is periodic. That's the time direction. That because of the trace here, the partition function. And if you look at the metric for a black hole, you find that this circle shrinks to nothing right at the horizon. So this is the spatial direction, radial direction outside the black hole. This is the time direction. So we just evaluate the Einstein-Maxwell action on this strange space-time, and you get the results. Okay. All right. So that's a quick summary of one of the most, you know, fundamental breakthrough calculations in physics. But really, in the end, it's not much more than that. And the way I presented it, it seems totally ridiculous. How can this make any sense? You have this complicated integral. You just look at the saddle point. Well, it does. Okay. So anyway, so if you believe this answer, which let's just suspend disbelief for now, what can we conclude? Well, first of all, if this is correct, this is telling you the entropy is finite, which is also surprising for a quantum field theory, but okay. That means there's a finite number of degrees of freedom. And it's not. But the most shocking thing about this entropy, it's not proportional to the volume. So if I did the Boltzmann did the calculation of entropy in this room, you would find the entropy is proportional to the volume. Any other system, any piece of copper, computer, its entropy is proportional to the volume. But here it's not proportional to the volume, it's proportional to the surface area. So that's kind of shocking. So this means that if I want to have a quantum mechanical system which has the same properties as a black hole, and let's say I'm a quantum computer person, I just want to take some qubits and build a quantum computer that looks like a black hole or simulates the properties of a black hole. But what kind of system must I take? Yes?
Excuse me. I calculated the entropy of a small volume.
Yeah.
I can't ignore the size.
Sure.
The interaction with the size.
Yeah.
That's only true if I had an infinite volume.
Right. Yeah, absolutely. You're right. But the microscopic degrees of freedom here are so tiny.
You know. I'm just concerned about it. I'm not so worried about it not being proportional to volume because I know that in the black hole I've got these sides, as it were, the horizon.
That's a good point. But the natural scale, if you actually compute how many bits do you need to get this entropy, is the Planck length. And so we're talking about a black hole which is much bigger than the Planck length. And the Planck length is, I forget, 10 to the minus 20 meters or something, minimum even minus 30, I think. It's very tiny. So we are assuming that the black hole is much, much bigger than the Planck length. Yeah. Anyway, so if I want to simulate the black hole with a quantum computer, Well, what you need is in the number of bits you're going to need, quantum bits or qubits, is proportional to the surface area, not the volume. So that's much fewer than you would naively guess for any other system. All right. Okay, so now let me mention another property of black holes, which was known earlier. Suppose you have, a black hole and you throw in something, a star falls in. It's going to vibrate a little bit, but eventually it'll settle down to a spherical shape, which is slightly bigger. So you can ask, what's called the ring down time? What's the time in which it settles down to a spherical shape? Well, this was computed, and it's of order 8 pi gm over c cubed. But now Hawking has told us a black hole is an object in thermal equilibrium. So if I take a quantum point of view, how long does it take for a black hole to relax to equilibrium? Well, I just compare this formula and this formula, and I find that this is equal to the Planckian time. So this is the first hint that there's some connection between strange metals and black holes. They both are systems that relax to equilibrium in the Planckian time. They seem to saturate with this time. And indeed, this is actual data from LIGO, where they measure the merger of pairs of black holes, and indeed find that, you can compute the Hawking temperature from the known mass and so on, and that they cluster very much around this time, h bar over kt, the time for these things to ring down and become a perfect sphere, the very last stage of the merger of two black holes. Okay, so there are a number of open questions here. So Hawking gave us an entropy, and then Boltzmann test tells us the entropy means that there is a density of states. But there's no mention of any states in Hawking's calculation. He's just doing a path integral. But to get states, we have to solve the Schrodinger equation. We have to get discrete states and count them. So is there a quantum system whose states we can count, which will give us this d of e? So that's really the most important question raised already by Hawking's calculation. So in fact, the answer to this is yes. String theory gave us a model in which you can count the states of a black hole. And the density of states in string theory ends up looking like this. There's a whole bunch of degenerate states at zero energy. And the number of those states is exactly the exponential of the entropy. So that was a triumph, that from string theory we found indeed a result consistent with this entropy. But as we'll see, the shape of this density of states is in fact very different from what actually happens in a generic black hole, which doesn't have all the special symmetries that string theory does. Anyway. Okay. So another question that raised by this is, even if you go beyond string theory, can we understand it in this holographic terms? In other words, in terms of a quantum computer or a quantum simulation that lives in one lower dimension. Is there a well-defined quantum system that obeys Schrodinger's equation, which has exactly the same density of states? But we can place a constraint on this quantum system. Since the black holes relax in a time h bar over kt, this quantum system must also relax in this time h bar over kt, i.e. it should be a system for which Boltzmann equation doesn't apply. It should be something like a strange metal. Okay. And then some of the deepest questions on black holes came up when thinking about what happens as this black hole is radiating energy and eventually shrinks down to nothing. All the energy leaves it. Now, that'll take a time much longer than the age of a universe, so we don't have to worry about it. But there's some contradictions there that Hawking pointed out in the time of in the evaporating black hole, which even led him to speculate for a while that maybe quantum mechanics breaks down in a black hole. So these questions, there's been a lot of progress in answering them, these questions, in the last few years. And in fact, there is no contradiction. Everything holds together, at least in some simple models. But I won't have time to talk about it, although I didn't contribute to this topic at all. But the methods I'm going to introduce, the simple model I'm going to describe now, has played a role in understanding this question. Okay, so now let me turn to my favorite model, which has helped understand, you know, advance the frontier of knowledge in these two very different sets of questions, all having to do with multiparticle entanglement and collisions between particles where there are strong correlations and you cannot apply Boltzmann's law. Okay, so it turns out that there is a model, which is the SYK model, in which you account for quantum interference between successive collisions and gives you a theory of multiparticle entanglement. And it leads to a metallic state with no particle-like excitations and many other properties which actually resemble, in fact, can be connected to the properties of certain black holes. So this is, I'm not saying that, you know, I'm going to use this model to suddenly compare it with IBCO. It's a model which seems to have the basic phenomena, but it's a rather artificial model, but it has basic phenomena that connects to both fields that I've been discussing. All right. So I end at 5:30, is that right? Okay, I'm doing good time. So let me just describe the model. It's really extremely simple. You take a bunch of sites, which I've numbered here from 1 through 19. So these are some states that electrons or fermions can occupy, and some fraction of them, occupy these states. You know, these states could be anything. They could be names of some molecular orbitals or actual positions in a material or anything. It's just a many-particle Hilbert space, and the electrons can occupy any fraction of these states. Okay, so now we have to solve Schrodinger's equation for these electrons, and we'll do it in the basis of these states. So, for example, you know, electron 11 and 12, whatever is the particle that's in position 11 and 12 can go to position 5 and 14. And in quantum mechanics, any one of these transitions is associated with the transition amplitude. So the U is a complex number, which gives me the amplitude for these two fermions to move from here to there. So that process has this amplitude, U11, 12, 5, 14, some complex number. And so then they can move. And then they can be, from 4, 5 to 11, 18, that has an amplitude and so on. So pick any pair of sites and go to any other empty sites, and every one of those is amplitudes. And all of these processes happen together. They happen in parallel. They're all happening, and you have to solve the Schrodinger equations given these amplitudes. So if you have n sites, there's 2 to the n states. So even for 100 sites, that's much larger than you can put on a computer. And there's n to the fourth amplitudes. These are numbers. So really, the task of a theorist is to figure out the time evolution of the system for a given set of amplitudes. The physical system will tell me what these numbers are, these U's. And then I have to solve for the many particle at time evolution. All right, so that's an impossible task. No hope of solving it. What we pointed out in 93 was that if you assume these amplitudes are independent random numbers, they're just uncorrelated random numbers, in the limit of a large number of sites, this is like a central limit theorem, if you wish, you can solve this problem and determine exactly. You can determine, most of the essentially all the properties you care about exactly. But the key step is assuming there's an independent random numbers. You can say, what does that mean? Well, there's no particular patterns. I'm not averaging over many samples. I'm just taking one sample, which is big enough, and it just gives you, in the end, average properties. So there's, of course, some set of numbers where they behave totally differently. But if you just pick any set of numbers, they'll behave essentially all will behave the way the solution says they behave. This has now been checked numerically to work. Anyway, so that's pretty much it. This is if you care about, here's the operator formulation of it. That's the Hamiltonian right there. And these are the independent random numbers. It's convenient to take them zero mean and mean square value U. So there's only one energy scale. You assume the density is around 1/2. And then you solve it. Okay, so this can be solved, and I won't show you the details. There's a review article soon to be out in Reviews of Modern Physics that has all of the details. So I'll skip them, but let me just tell you what you find out when you solve this model. You know, there's nothing under the rug. That is the model. That's it. Independent random numbers for any two-particle amplitude. So what you find, first of all, is that this is a system which relaxes to equilibrium in the Planckian time. Not always, as long as the temperature is lower than the natural energy scale. This is already quite, you know, remarkable. If you solve in Boltzmann equation, that's never the case. In Boltzmann equation, the relaxation time depends on the collision cross-section. And the collision cross-section is a number, some energy scale characterizing a given system. And that energy scale will determine the scale of your relaxation. Here, if you go to low enough temperatures, the microscopic energy scale, the value of U, doesn't appear anywhere. It becomes universal. It's just determined by temperature. That's it. And it's this Planckian time. So that's quite interesting. And there are no quasi-particles. I guess I should have said that. I'll say that again. So then you compute the entropy as temperature goes to zero. More formally, you look at the entropy density as temperature goes to zero, and you find it's non-zero. So this seems a little scary. Seems like your, you know, most any thermodynamic system you can think of, the entropy vanishes as temperature goes to zero. However, and you might think this is because of some huge degeneracy in the ground state. There's many, many states of the same energy, but that's not the case. So here's actually the energy eigenstates. If you just put it on a computer, there's, in this case, there's about 65,000 states here. This is the density of those states. This is D of E. If you zoom in to the bottom, you find that this density of states we can show has this functional form, and that gives you an entropy which doesn't vanish as temperature goes to zero. That's this number S0 that we computed, which can be checked numerically. And if you zoom in to the bottom, you find that there's no degeneracy at all. It's just the states are very, very, very dense, all the way down to the ground state. So there's a state here, there's a next state there, a next state there, all completely different entangled states of all the electrons. If you took a material like copper, you'd have some complicated ground state. You look at the first excited state, that'll be very simply connected to the ground state. It's as if you moved one particle here to there. That's the first excited state. The simple quasi-particle interpretation in the Boltzmann sense as you go from one state to the next. Here, that's not what happens. You get a very dense set of states which are all chaotically independent of each other, and you know the precise density of those states. Okay, so that's the behavior. And how is this D of E? These results are just presented here, analytic results which are checked numerically. How are they obtained? Well, they're obtained by doing a path integral over this theory. And amazingly, the path integral starts to look like gravity. It turns out to be a path integral over reparameterization of time. There's no space here, there's only time. So if you have a metric in time, or in other words, you reparameterize time from tau to f of tau, you get a path integral over f. I'll ignore the other phi field. So you get some action for time reparameterizations, and you evaluate this action in the Feynman sense, and you get the results I've just shown you. Okay. All right. So that's a quick summary of the SYK model. At least, hopefully, I made clear what the model is and what some of its properties are. I certainly didn't give you enough details to see how those properties were understood. You know, that was many years of work. I first proposed the model in 1993, and it's only recently that many of those things have been fully understood. Okay, so how is this connected to black holes? So it turns out to be a very precise connection. For certain black holes, in fact, it's connected to what are called charged black holes. So imagine a black hole that has a net charge. Unfortunately, there's no such black holes out there, almost certainly. Everything is neutral. The number of positive and negative charges are always the same in any astrophysical object. But if you had a net in some region of space, net excess of positive versus negative charges, and the system collapsed into a black hole. That's allowed by Einstein's equations. You'll get a solution, which is called the Reisner-Nordström solution for the metric of such a black hole. And what do you find? Well, you find for such a black hole is that when you're far away from the black hole, space-time looks like our space-time. It has three space and one time dimension. But as you fall into the black hole, as you're getting very close to the horizon, you find that the transverse directions kind of disappear from view. And to the falling observer, the world looks just one spatial dimension. There's one space and one time. So this is the more formal statement. There's a space-time called ADS2, which is one space and one time dimension. That's the two in the subscript. It has a uniform negative curvature. That's why it's called ADS. It's like a sphere, but with negative curvature. And so as you're falling into the black hole, space looks one-dimensional. Now, that's great for us theorists because one is smaller than three and one is easier to work with than three. So you try to do a theory of quantum gravity in one space and one time dimension. Okay. And that turns out to be something you can do. It was only completely done recently, but it can be done. And what the principle of holography would tell us, you know, remember, Hawking found that the entropy was proportional to the surface area, and therefore the quantum simulation was in one lower dimension. So if you're falling down a charged black hole and space is one-dimensional, what is one lower dimension from one? It's zero. So there should be a zero-dimensional quantum system which has the same physics as ADS2, as is 1 plus 1-dimensional space-time. So is there a nice system in zero space dimensions which has no quasi-particles? Of course, I just told you about one. That's the SYK model. And amazingly, it turns out that the low-energy theory of the SYK model that you obtain by solving the equations I showed you earlier turns out to be exactly the same theory you would get by doing a Feynman path integral of the Einstein theory in one space in one time dimension. So this is the correspondence. You can start from Einstein's equations. You can set it up as a path integral. Then near a charged black hole, it'll be a path integral only in one space zeta and one time direction. And this turns out to be equal, literally equal, to the path integral you would get by starting from the SYK model of these random electrons and just doing more conventional path integral methods. You get exactly the same theory, where the boundary component of G becomes a time parameterization of the SYK model. So this fluctuation of this boundary between space being 1 to space being 3, this boundary has a graviton. That graviton has the same action as the time parameterizations of the SYK model. Okay, yeah, that's a lot to swallow, but anyway, it's true.
What does it mean when you say the low energy theory of a charged black hole?
Yeah.
Imagine a charged black hole.
Yes.
What is?
Well, by adjusting the mass and the charge, so black hole has a temperature. Okay, so you want to take a black hole with a very low temperature. Okay, and that in practice, that means you have to adjust the mass and the charge in the right way so that the temperature is very low. It's called the extremal black hole. Anyway. Okay, so there it is. And so now you can just turn the crank. Now we can compute the entropy of the black hole. You can compute the correction to Hawking's answer. And you can even compute the density of states I showed you. So this picture was obtained for a particular set of random U's. You just diagonalize that model and you get this density of states, which obeys this specific functional form. So the claim is that for charged black hole, the same is true. It's the same density of state, the same functional form, except the parameters are expressed in terms of the black hole. A0 is the area of the black hole at zero temperature, and Newton's constant, the velocity of light. That's all you need to know. Now, it's not the statement that every energy level here is the same for a black hole as for the SYK model. the details of the energy level depend on all kinds of things. For the black hole, probably they depend on what happens, whether the string theory is right or wrong. We don't know every energy level. But we can compute a lot about them. We can compute the density of them and many other properties. And those are the same. So there are certain many coarse-grained properties are exactly the same, literally exactly the same, for the simple SYK model as for this black hole. And these, for the case of the black hole, those are obtained by just extending the Hawking calculation, by just doing the path integral a little bit better than Hawking did. All right, so I think that's really all I had to say about black holes. I do have a few minutes to close the loop now. The reason I started working the SYK model, not because I cared anything about black holes, certainly in 93, I didn't know what a black hole was. Well, I knew a little bit, but not much. All I saw in my graduate course in general relativity, taught by Weinberg's book on general relativity, which actually doesn't mention black holes at all, at least that edition. Anyway, okay, I'm getting sidetracked. The reason I was working on the SYK model was to understand this puzzle of the strange metal. So this problem actually turned out to be harder than the black hole problem in some sense. We think we have made some progress recently to come up with a realistic model. You know, taking these random U's is not a realistic model of lanthanum copper oxide. There's a very particular crystal structure with a very particular set of electrons, and they're coupled to various other, quantum phase transition that may be happening. So we think the model that's going to work is if you take free electrons which are occupying some states inside a Fermi surface, and you couple them to some boson, not a phonon, but some other boson that's emergent having to do with some phase transition nearby, we call that phi. So it's a critical boson, you know, some critical point. And then you couple them together with this so-called Yukawa coupling, psi dagger psi phi, with some coupling constant g. So this particular problem that many people have studied, but it's turned out to be extremely hard to solve. But moreover, we need to add some randomness, some disorder into the system to get any resistivity at all. And so what we have realized is that if you take a system like this, where you have kind of a SYK-like Yukawa coupling, it's random both in flavor space and in position space, that this kind of theory does indeed give you much of the observed phenomenology. So this is just a very recent paper from a few months ago. We're pretty excited about it, and I think it's inspired by the SYK model to come up with a way to talk about transport in metals where you have strong entanglement. Okay, I think I'm done, so let me just summarize. So what is the SYK model? It's a solvable model without particle-like excitations, which exhibits thermalization and many-body chaos in this Planckian time. And, that's quite remarkable already, because no microscopic energy scale determines how long it takes to relax to equilibrium, just h bar over temperature. This SYK model has a low energy theory, which is a theory of time reparamerizations, and that turns out to be exactly the same, literally the same action, as the theory of the boundary graviton in quantum gravity in one space and one time dimension. And therefore, by using this connection, we can now answer some of the questions I posed about black holes, that in fact Hawking's answer can be reproduced by a completely sensible quantum system. And even there's been a lot of work by many other people on understanding what's called the Page curve, which describes the evolution of the entropy of an evaporating black hole. And finally, in very recent work with my former student Avishkar Patel, and current student Ha Yu Guo, and current postdoc Ilya Estelis, we've been using this idea to understand one of the main open problems in the theory of strange metal, which is this linear T resistivity. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Sachdev. Are there questions?
Hey, thank you very much. Sure. So I'm trying to understand what it means for theory not to admit particle-like excitations. Can you explain a little bit more about that?
Well, in one term, it's simply, can you apply Boltzmann equation or not? But another more precise way to say it is that if you look, suppose you have a complicated many-body system, and then you, it has to be a very large system in the thermodynamic limit, and then you look at its low-energy states, okay? So for a system with quasi-particles, the low-energy states so can be described in the following way. You have some occupation number of a certain set of states, and then you say that this energy of some state is given by n alpha times e alpha. N alpha is 0 or 1. So if a certain state is occupied or empty, then it's 0 or 1. Plus, there can be interaction. So you can have some f alpha beta, n alpha, n beta. And then you're going to have terms order n cubed, so on. So if you can make such an expansion for, you know, so if you have, say, alpha goes from 1 to n, so the total number of many-body states, roughly speaking, is 2 to the n. So you have 2 to the n many-body states. We're just looking at the very low-energy parts of those. Then the claim is that in a system with quasi-particles, you can describe these all these low-energy states in this kind of expansion by which states are occupied and how they interact with each other. And the one thing you notice now is that the number of parameters here is much smaller than the number of states. You know, E alpha, there's n of these. F alpha beta, there's n squared of those. So it's a polynomial number of parameters. And you're describing an exponentially large number of states. So if you can do that, then you have quasi-particles. And the many-body states are really, you can think of many-body states as the low-lying states, it's just rearrangements of certain particles from here to there. You know, you have some ground state, which is, could be very complicated. But if you want some excited state, you just take a little bit from here and you maybe put it over there. That's the excited state. But the rest of the system doesn't change very much. So that now, if you have, you know, if you open a textbook, they won't talk about it this way, because in a textbook, they assume momentum conservation, and then they talk about delta functions in various Green's functions. That's fine. There's nothing wrong with that definition, but it's a much more general concept that doesn't even require translation invariance. So momentum need not be a good quantum number. It becomes harder to define what a quasi-particle is, but roughly the statement is that when you go from the low-lying states are simply rearrangements of more elementary quasi-particles. Whereas if your system doesn't have quasi-particles, that's simply not the case. So, you know, when I showed you these energy levels, if you actually looked at the wave function of these low-lying states here, well, they're just totally different from each other. They're not simple rearrangements of a few occupation numbers. That's a more complicated system. Yeah.
A historical question. I'm embarrassed that I never thought about this before.
Yeah.
But Boltzmann died in 1906. How did Boltzmann react to Planck's discovery?
I don't know, actually. I don't. 1906. You know, I think most people didn't think much about such. When did he die? 1906. Oh, you're right. Okay. Planck's discovery is 1900.
Yeah. Exactly.
I think it took many years for the implication of Planck's discovery to sink in. There was Einstein's photoelectric effect was 1905, I think. Or,
yeah.
And where he used the same Planck's constant to deduce something else. And Bohr model was 1915. Hard for me to realize, but, you know, 1905, most people didn't care about Planck at that point, I suspect.
Well, some important people did, like Einstein.
Well, Einstein wasn't considered very important at that time either. He didn't even have a job. Right, so, you know, I don't know. I don't know the answer to that at all. But I'm just guessing that
it wasn't clear then that Planck's observation was an earth-shaking observation, I think.
Well, Planck did realize that with that constant, he now had a Planck mask.
Oh, yeah, sure.
So there were...
Right. I mean, Boltzmann, perhaps you know, he committed suicide in 1906. And people say, well, who knows? People say he was distraught over people not accepting the discoveries I've presented here, which is the statistical interpretation of entropy, and also the fact that Boltzmann's equation has an arrow of time, which it does, and the reason it has an arrow of time because you average because of statistical independence and the initial conditions that you assume. I mean, it's all very well understood now, but not at that time. Also, 1905 was Einstein's paper on Brownian motion, which was the first time that was, further evidence of the existence of molecules. They even had a number. Avogadro's number was only understood around that time, much after Boltzmann written down his equations. So, in fact, his KB, was R divided by Avogadro's number. I'm not sure he knew that. Or exactly how when that it became clear.
Is there a final question? Well, let's thank our speaker again. And don't forget to come back tomorrow, 4:30, and bring your friends. It'll be public talk. Should be really exciting.